So for today, our first speaker is Natasha Cooper. She works with Dare in Kiva. For the ones who are unaware of Dare in Kiva, it's a notified body. Dare previously already existed as a notified body, and I think Kiva joined together with Dare, and they're growing rapidly in the medical devices field. So Natasha, in her background, she's a veterinarian and has done a PhD at the UMC Utrecht here in the Netherlands. Also, she's responsible at the notified body for product technical and clinical reviews. And she, what's good to mention is that she's a board member of the REPS in the Netherlands. So we asked Natasha to provide a short presentation, a presentation on the common findings that you can find in technical file reviews for software as a medical device, and then specifically in making the transfer from MDD to MDR. So this should be a really interesting topic, and I hope you enjoy. Natasha, if I can give it over to you.
Thank you. Yeah.
So welcome.
Yes, thanks for the introduction. And of course, thanks for organizing this interesting conference. And indeed, as Leon said, as a notified body, Kiva Dare Services, we see a lot of software devices. And I would like to share some insights in what we see as common findings, in the hope that you can avoid them when you are doing your own application as a manufacturer. Let me see how I can start sharing my screen. Yes. Okay. Go to presentation view. Okay. If everything is well, you can see my screen now. As I said, I'm going to discuss common findings in software as a medical device applications. Hopefully that helps to avoid these things when you're doing your own application. So let's first start with the basics. Technical documentation needs to be structured and organized and searchable. This facilitates our own review as a notified body, but it's also now a hard requirement in the MDR. What we often see is that this structure is present internally because the manufacturer uses documentation tools like I just discussed or other tools. But it's sometimes difficult to extract the whole thing for us to review. So the technical documentation. As I said, structured, organized, and searchable. And especially make sure that you submit the complete thing. So it's best to look at it that we are, of course, we are not part of the manufacturer's company. So for us, we have to look at it from the outside. So you really should look at it with that vision and see, okay, do I have everything here? And is it sufficiently structured? Because we are, of course, not working in any documentation internal tools that you are using. So this is very important. With regard to the quality management system, I'm not an auditor, so I won't go into too much detail, but I would like to point out that there is this EMDRF guidance on how to implement your software development lifecycle into your quality management system. So that's a good thing to look at that as well. Okay, then if you go a bit more into detail, of course, it all starts with qualification and classification. So first you have to decide if your software actually is a medical device. And you have to do this before any classification, because sometimes it might fit the classification rules, but still is not a medical device. And so it should be intended for the individual patient. It should do some processing of any data or anything. And you have to look at this if this truly qualifies. For example, if you have an artificial intelligence that is for logistic reasons, looking at readmission rate to see how many beds are need to be there or something, that's not a medical device. Because the aim is logistics and not to the benefit of the individual patient. And then, of course, you have to classify it. And if you come out with class one, then I would say maybe you have a look again if you did classify it correctly, because it's highly unlikely with the rule 11 that we now have that your software is class one. If you need more information, you can look at this guidance, MCG 2019-11. It also gives some good examples on how your software can be classified. And of course, sometimes it is difficult and there's a bit of a gray area, but at least this guidance will help you in going through it and make your decisions. Another part that we see a lot of errors is labeling. This is quite understandable because the MDR is not very clear, it's of course mainly focused on hardware devices, and for software it can be somewhat unclear how you should label it. When your software has a user interface, it's not that difficult. You have to have it on a readily accessible screen, so an about file or startup screen, and there you have your labeling. But without the user interface, it's a different story, of course. And in that case, it is allowed to make it visible through your AP, so through your application programming interface. So for example, I've seen examples with use of a comment line or a root folder with an image of the label, or maybe if your software is printing a report or processing an image, that you put the label also on there. So there are different solutions for this, but you must make sure that this includes the UDI, also the application identifier. So in the string of numbers, it should be clear what is what means what. The identification is a medical device. This is often forgotten, that you should state it's a medical device or use the symbol for that. And the CE with the notified body number. And this last is an example of a bit of a gray area, because if you use a comment line, of course, you just get plain text, so you cannot use the actual logo format as it should be. As a notified body, we accept this. We accept if you do it that way, that it's just CE with a notified body number, because it's, for us, it's clear enough that we have certified it. But I'm not sure if every notified body will look at it that way. So this is one of the examples where it's still a bit unclear how you should do this. Then if you go on labeling, you see that UDI is sometimes incorrectly applied. Of course, UDI is already known from the USA system. But what we also have now is basic UDI, and that's a new thing. The basic UDI is not present on the labeling. It's more like an identifier of a product model. So it's linked to one technical documentation, and it should include all versions, because in hardware it would include several variants. It's actually meant for this device, all device variants with the same intended purpose and similar technical characteristics. So if you make a new software version, you don't need to apply a new basic UDI, but you do need to change your UDI DI, so the thing that's on the labeling, if you do a major change. So if you do a change in the performance, that affects the performance or the safety or your data interpretation, if you make a major version change, or if you change anything in your warnings, contraindications, or the language of your user interface, then you should make an UDI DI change. And when you do a minor change, you should do an UDI PI change. So if you only make a bug fix or an enhanced user interface, something like that. It's a bit like the major and minor versions in the software that are already commonly used. So this is something that you should look at. Then if you go further in the technical file, is the use of standards. And I'm deliberately writing here, the use of standards is not clear. I'm not saying standards are not used, because it's not mandatory to use a standard. A standard is in principle always voluntary. However, you should, if you don't use standards, you should make clear that your own methods are of a comparable level of compliance. So this can be quite difficult, especially for process standards sometimes. If you do that, you have to justify that, of course. And also, what we in principle, because we don't have harmonized standards yet, we say, okay, use the latest version, or make sure that you have a justification or a gap analysis, because you have to show, of course, that you're state of the art. Then a standard that we often see missing, and without a justification or a comparable level of compliance, is the 82304. The standard has some specific validation requirements for software, and there are some items that are very important, so you should definitely look at the standard. And the 62304, we see that I don't think I've ever seen an application where this was not applied. And I think most software developers are aware that for medical devices are aware that this standard exists. What we do sometimes see is that we don't agree on the classification. We see that class A is applied, but there is a risk of non-serious injury. Of course, your software is doing something. It's providing information, even though it's only supportive, and this information is used one way or the other. Otherwise, you wouldn't need to have the software. So you can easily have at least a delay of treatment or an incorrect treatment, and this can already be considered a non-serious injury. So you have to think, you have to look at the classification and not too easily think that you can use class A. It's often at least class B. Oh, I'm going a bit too far. Then the verification and validation. We sometimes see that this is incomplete. some cases it's really incomplete in the sense that parts have not been done. I don't see that often with software. I see that more with hardware, because I think that software, as I said, software developers often already use the 6.2.3 or 6.4, and then you're really going through this VNV process and making sure that you have all deliverables. It's more that not everything is delivered. It's the same problem that I told about in the beginning, that if you have a digitalized TD, which is of course a very good thing to have, but it's sometimes a bit difficult to make sure that you extract everything for us to review. And we must be able to follow the complete path. So we go from the requirements, we need to see the traceability matrix to make sure that they are linked, the requirements are linked with the verifications. We want to see the plans to see if the actual reports show that the plans have been followed or deviations have been explained. We want to see the results in a dated and signed or otherwise approved reports. And if you're doing risk management, we really want to see the risk mitigations that are linked to the verification and validation, because we actually take samples of that and also of the verification requirements, and we follow them up, and we want to see if we can follow the whole pathway from the beginning to the end. And this is often that we have to write non-conformities because there are caps. So please make sure that you have everything delivered, because it's such a shame if all the information is there, we just didn't see it, and we have to write a non-conformity. Another important thing is cybersecurity, of course, gets a lot of attention nowadays. Also in the MDR, it's a specific section on this. It should be, at least we expected to see it in the risk analysis. And sometimes then you conclude that no more action is needed because you don't save, for example, any patient data or whatever, then that's okay. But it needs to be at least there. And if there's any more than that, if you have patient data that is kept on in your software, or there's unauthorized access can be a problem, something like that, then of course you need to take measures and to do the verification and validation. And there's also an MDCG for this, a guidance document, the 2019-16. And you can look into that guidance on how you should do that and implement that. Then going on to risk management. As I said over the previous slides, several instances we've already seen something on risk management. But more in general, what we sometimes see is that the severity levels are unclearly defined. So what we, for example, see is that they're totally not related to software. That is, I think in that case, someone used some general template that was not really applicable to software. There are things in there like the patient getting burned or a shock. It's of course not possible with the software. So it should be really made specific for your device. And what we also sometimes see missing is that there's no clear explanation of the severity of the risk. Of course, as I just said, the software often doesn't have a direct effect on the patient. So it's mainly arising from any incorrect function. And then we need to be able to follow what can happen in that case. And it depends, of course, is your software really doing diagnostics? That that's a single source of information for the caregiver, or is it more supportive together with other information? What kind of medical indication, or how? What is the harm that can occur if that's not treated correctly? So all these things need to be clearly explained so that we can follow where you're coming from, how you define your severity. And furthermore, I would like to point out that in this case, it's quite unlikely that severity decreases after mitigation. For example, in a hardware device, you may have, for example, sharp edges. And if you make them less sharp, then you have a less severity, because you cannot get a cut, but only less severe kind of harm. But for incorrect software function, that often doesn't change, of course. If your incorrect function leads to a certain problem with the treatment, then that remains the same. And you can only make the probability lower by software validation or warning or whatever. I'm not saying it's never possible, but you have to look very clearly if you decrease your severity, if this is actually the case, if this is actually true, that this is reduced. And going on to usability, we sometimes see that this is omitted, and not when software has a user interface. I never see that this is forgotten, because most people understand that if you have a user interface, you also need some kind of usability. But especially without a user interface, it's easy to think, okay, I don't have a user interface, so I don't have any usability issues. But you have to realize that usability is broader than that. because there are other ways of interaction besides things like installation or maintenance of the software. There's also the interaction of the user with, for example, instructions for use and safety information. There might be some specific warnings or limitations or the patient group that's applicable for. And it's very important to with your usability to check if all this information is correctly understood. And that also accounts for training if you have any training in your process. And of course, the output of the software. I assume that software is generating an output, otherwise it won't be really useful. So if it generates, for example, a report or an image, then the user interacts with that report or that image, and it needs to understand what he or she is looking at. So that's also a usability aspect that should be covered. Then going on to the clinical performance, clinical evaluation. What we sometimes see is that the clinical performance data is missing. So in that case, you see that we have the technical performance. It's mainly the following the 62304 and doing all the verification and validation. And it's very clear that there is that the input is giving the correct output, and that's all okay. And there's a valid clinical association because, for example, literature has been collected showing that the output is really linked to the medical indication. But then we are missing the actual clinical performance in the clinical setting, sometimes called clinical utility. And it depends a bit on the software how much you need of this. If your software has an indirect clinical claim, it's only generating a single output that has been long known to be associated with a medical indication, it might be sufficient to do usability. But yeah, you have to make sure that's sufficiently thorough, that usability, that the people can actually work with the software. But as soon as your device or your software has a direct clinical claim, so it's doing a direct diagnosis, or if it's interacting, for example, if you use the software during a clinical intervention, it's providing information, for example, during an intervention, something like that, then you're already in the territory where you actually need clinical data. So you have to make sure that you have this data, either by looking at the clinical data from an equivalent software device, but then, of course, you have to guarantee sufficient equivalence. And this goes quite far. There's also an MDCG on equivalence that you can look at, because you have to do that up to the algorithm level. Or you have to do, of course, a clinical investigation with your actual software. So you have to make sure that you do all these three steps. You have your technical performance, you have your flat clinical association, and then you need to show that the actual clinical performance is there. And if you look a bit further into this, we can also see it's the other way around. And we see that the literature review is omitted. So this is often the case when the manufacturer has done a clinical investigation with their software, and they think, okay, we have our own clinical data. We don't use an equivalent device, so we don't need to do a literature review. But you have to realize that the literature review is more general or more broader than that, because it's also important to determine the state of the art. And this is an actual requirement in the MDR. You have to determine the state of the art. You have to compare your device to that. You have to look at any alternative treatment options. And of course, your valid clinical association is often coming out of the literature review. So even though you don't use an equivalent device, you still need a structured literature review. And it's also very important that it's actually a structured review and not just some sampling or collection of some papers. Because, if, for example, if your basis of your algorithms is used for any calculation of outcomes, is based on guidelines or scientific papers, we need to know that it's not just any paper, but it's really the state-of-the-art paper, a conventionally accepted paper, something like that. So you, you also need a structured literature review. And of course, it's important to identify any issues or hazards related to similar software devices. So this literature review should always be done. After your clinical evaluation, of course, you go to your post-market surveillance and post-market clinical follow-up. And here we see a lot of omissions, not even specific for software. I have to write this non-conformity very often for almost all devices. For PMS, that is that not all requirements of NX3 are met. There's a quite clear list of requirements in NX3. And you should make sure that every part of this list is coming back on your PMS plan, even though it might be less applicable. You can explain that, but you have to make sure that all the requirements are there. And on the content level, you of course have to make sure that you're sufficiently proactive. We also sometimes see that this is not, there's still quite a passive way of collecting data, and that is not allowed anymore. The MDR is really focusing on proactive collection of data, so surveys, active data collection from clinical from the users. So definitely look at Annex 3 and make sure that you have all the elements there. And if you look at PMCF, that's sometimes omitted. And again, that's understandable because in the MDD, PMCF always referred very specifically to a PMCF study, and that might not always be needed. If you did your own clinical investigation, you don't have any unanswered questions, you might not need to do a specific PMCF study. But in the MDR, this is made more broader, and it includes also general methods of PMCF now. So those are described in Annex 14, Part B. So you should definitely also look into that. And that includes, for example, things like literature review, clinical use data, any indications of label use, literature from similar devices. So that part, there's no you should always do that part. It's always necessary to collect this data, even if you don't do a specific study. And there are also two MDCG templates, actually, for your PMCF plan and your PMCF report. As a notified body, we do not request that you use these templates. As long as we see that every information, every item from Annex 14 is included, that's fine with us. I don't know how other note might be that other notified bodies do require to use this template. So yeah, maybe it's best to just use them because all the requirements are then in there already, and you have the commonly accepted format, and you can find them again with the MDCG documentation. Then, as a final note, I want to say something about artificial intelligence. Specifically, of course, there you have a bit of a different situation that you use this training and validation data sets, and also your methodology is a bit different from other software. What we see missing in these cases often is that there's no clear description of the methodology for development. And it's not the case that this is not present, because it's often present in a technical part. But you have to realize that if your technical dossier is reviewed, that the clinical part is often assessed by a different person than the technical part. So, and also, of course, it's important because this methodology is an important aspect of your clinical evaluation. So you should make sure that you either have a summary of this methodology in your clinical evaluation report, or you have a reference to another document where this is described, but that there's this link is there that you can read the clinical evaluation report and then find where the methodology for development is described. And I think this point is easily to solve, of course. The second point might be a bit more of a problem because if your data set was not sufficient, you have to do rework. But you have to make sure, therefore, beforehand that you use methods to ensure that you have sufficient presence of all outcomes groups and that the size of your data sets is sufficient for what you want to use your AI for. And we also often see that there's no clear description of the data set and demographics. And we want to see that because we want, of course, to see if your data set was sufficient general for your application. So you have to make sure that you include this description also in your clinical evaluation. So these were some main points that I wanted to discuss of things that we often see. Thank you for your attention. And if there's some time still, I am happy to answer some questions.
Yeah, it's super interesting. Thanks a lot for your presentation. I do see a number of questions, and I'm going to pick out two that were asked. And the first question that was regarding the labeling. So you mentioned that you saw some findings on the labeling, and one of the questions that came in is, as a notified body, do you find it acceptable if people will put, for example, if a device generates PDF reports that are being presented to a physician, is it okay to put the labeling on the information on the report that's actually generated by the software?
Yeah, it's a very good question. We had this issue, and it's not absolutely not clear in the legislation if this is allowed. For us, we have decided that we accept this because we see this as generated through the API, as it is stated in the MDR. It's also very clear because every time you make this report, you have this label in your hand, if it's printed on the report. So we don't accept if it's just, we also seen this sometimes that it's just present on the manual, for example. But we say, manual can be older or it can be lost. So we don't accept that. But in a report, every time you generate the report, you have the labeling as a physician. for you, sorry. So for us, it's acceptable, but I cannot say if other notified bodies accept this as well, because it's not very clear in the legislation.
And one other question that came in was regarding PMS. So you mentioned as an example that you can take questionnaires as a form of proactive PMS. Do you see that there's any other methods that are acceptable for proactive PMS?
I've seen it a bit. I've seen several examples. Things you can, from software, you can also, of course, collect data that is sometimes, it's possible to generate data that's collected in the software. Sometimes it's indeed, if you use questionnaires, it is possible, but you have to make sure, especially for your PMCF part, that you make them sufficient about the actual clinical use, and not just are you content with the product. You also see sometimes that it's actually more like interviews, that they are actually approaching users. So yeah, there are several ways that you can do this. And yeah, I've also seen several ways. And so you have to make sure that you just, that you are able to collect data that you can, for example, after a year, you can say, okay, I have now a good view on how my device is used or misused in a clinical situation. And you won't have that if you just collect complaints. But yeah, there are definitely different ways to collect this data.
There's more questions coming in. I'd like to address, if I think we have two more minutes, so maybe we can briefly address two questions very briefly. One is if it's acceptable to use US clinical investigation data to for CE marking for clearing a software device.
Yeah, well, in principle, it is. Well, for, if you have class 3, it's a bit more difficult. The crimes are a bit more stricter. But in the lower classes, you can use any clinical investigation data, but you have to consider where they were generated. So first, you have to consider if the population is comparable. It can, of course, be a difference that is important, especially with AI. You have this, of course. And the second part is that you have to make sure that the requirements of the MDR are met. And they're not literally met in the sense that the USA clinical investigation is looking at the MDR, of course. But you can look yourself at the requirements and then see if the clinical investigation is also meeting the requirements for the from the MDR.
Yeah, and then I think that's really clear. And I think also to your point, right? And I think one thing that's good to consider for manufacturers is also that if you get data from other regions, then there might be other clinical protocols that were involved in obtaining the data. And those kind of differences would need to be considered.
Yes.
Exactly. Definitely. Yeah, good point. I have one last comment. One question, sorry. If you need statistical justification for the appropriate data set size for AI SAMD, and I assume that in the question is the statistical justification would mean for the validation data set that's used for the clinical validation.
Yeah, that definitely is. Yeah, of course, you have to, as I said, you have to make sure that your data sets are sufficient, and that is, in principle, that's based on statistical, like just any clinical investigation, to statistically determine your sample size. Yeah.
Thanks a lot. I will leave it here. I see a lot of thanks from the people in the comments on the live stream. So thank you, Natasha. And then we're going to transition to the next, to the lightning talks. So feel free to drop off, Natasha, or start keep listening in.